morning and welcome to Morningstar Baptist Church. I want you to prepare for a worship experience where we celebrate, worship, and connect. I'm so excited, and I hope that you are also. I'm Chandra Johnson, here with your MSBC News. Tithing, it's more than giving. It's investing in something greater. So let's sow generously and reap abundantly together, knowing that every contribution makes a difference in building the kingdom of God. There are a few ways for you to invest. If you feel comfortable investing electronically, you can choose from PayPal, Givelify, or Cash App. But if we're together in worship, just raise your hand and an usher will bring you an envelope. Or stop by the post office and drop your investment in the mail. Prayer is our direct line to solace, guidance, and growth. It offers strength and adversity, clarity and confusion, and abundant gratitude. Let's make sure that we extend these characteristics outside of our church and to those on our prayer list. Listen up. The following two announcements are just for you. The Men of Valor are inviting you to attend their conference on April 19th and April 20th. You know that iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. You can register for this free event at movemanupnation.org. After you've taken care of your spiritual man, you must also check in on your physical man. So I'm inviting you to sign up for the Metro Health Men's Health Fair on Saturday, April 27th, 2024. There's going to be various health screenings and community and career resources. You also have the option of two locations to choose from. So head on over to metrohealth.org/MMF to register today. Attention all Silver Stars. They want you to join them for a meet and greet on Saturday, April 13th from noon to 2. They've missed you and they can't wait to see you. There is nothing that beats the feeling of worshiping in person, to experience God in His house with other like-minded worshipers. That's why I'm inviting you to join us at Morningstar Baptist Church at 10 a.m. Your presence will be a valuable addition to our journey together. You are welcome to come as you are and share in the warmth of our fellowship and faith. We'll see you next Sunday. Connection is vital, and that's why we want to stay connected. So follow us on social media or visit our website for more information about this fantastic church. Now the time has come to put everything aside so that we can receive a word from the Lord. I'm Chandra Johnson, and this has been your MSBC News. Good morning, and welcome to Morningstar Baptist Church. I want you to prepare for a worship experience where we celebrate, worship, and connect. I'm so excited, and I hope that you are also. I'm Chandra Johnson, here with your MSBC News. Tithing, it's more than giving. It's investing in something greater. So let's sow generously and reap abundantly together, knowing that every contribution makes a difference in building the kingdom of God. There are a few ways for you to invest. If you feel comfortable investing electronically, you can choose from PayPal, Givelify, or Cash App. But if we're together in worship, just raise your hand and an usher will bring you an envelope. Or stop by the post office and drop your investment in the mail. Prayer is our direct line to solace, guidance, and growth. It offers strength and adversity, clarity and confusion, and abundant gratitude. Let's make sure that we extend these characteristics outside of our church and to those on our prayer list. Listen up. The following two announcements are just for you. The Men of Valor are inviting you to attend their conference on April 19th and April 20th. You know that iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. You can register for this free event at movemanupnation.org. After you've taken care of your spiritual man, you must also check in on your physical man. So I'm inviting you to sign up for the Metro Health Men's Health Fair on Saturday, April 27th, 2024. There's going to be various health screenings and community and career resources. You also have the option of two locations to choose from. So head on over to metrohealth.org/MMF to register today. Attention all Silver Stars. They want you to join them for a meet and greet on Saturday, April 13th from noon to 2. They've missed you and they can't wait to see you. There is nothing that beats the feeling of worshiping in person, to experience God in His house with other like-minded worshipers. That's why I'm inviting you to join us at Morning Star Baptist Church at 10 a.m. Your presence will be a valuable addition to our journey together. You are welcome to come as you are and share in the warmth of our fellowship and faith. We'll see you next Sunday. Connection is vital, and that's why we want to stay connected. So follow us on social media or visit our website for more information about this fantastic church. Now the time has come to put everything aside so that we can receive a word from the Lord. I'm Chandra Johnson, and this has been your MSBC News. Good morning, and welcome to Morning Star Baptist Church. I want you to prepare for a worship experience where we celebrate, worship, and connect. I'm so excited, and I hope that you are also. I'm Chandra Johnson, here with your MSBC News. Tithing, it's more than giving. It's investing in something greater. So let's sow generously and reap abundantly together, knowing that every contribution makes a difference in building the kingdom of God. There are a few ways for you to invest. If you feel comfortable investing electronically, you can choose from PayPal, Givelify, or Cash App. But if we're together in worship, just raise your hand and an usher will bring you an envelope. Or stop by the post office and drop your investment in the mail. Prayer is our direct line to solace, guidance, and growth. It offers strength and adversity, clarity and confusion, and abundant gratitude. Let's make sure that we extend these characteristics outside of our church and to those on our prayer list.
Welcome to Morning Star Baptist Church, Cleveland, Ohio. We are under the leadership of the Reverend Dr. Clarence Hall Jr., and we are glad that you're here. We believe that Morning Star is the place to be. Come on, put your hands together for Morning Star. And our call to worship today that can be found in Psalm 40. David says this: I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Many will see it in fear and will trust in the Lord. Blessed is that man who makes the Lord his trust and does not respect the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. I don't know about you, but I will trust in the Lord until I die. And with that, let's enter into praise and worship.
Come on, put your hands. It's Sunday morning. That sounds like Sunday morning in here. Put your hands together. Yeah. Yes, that's it. I like that sound. We have carpet now. We used to have wood floors. So Dion, make that kick a little bit more so that we can hear that old church sound. Okay, come on, y'all. All magnified.
Oh,
Star, I remember there was an advertisement for insurance. Prudential Insurance, The Rock. I don't know about that, because if my money is funny, I can't afford Prudential. And when their lawyers get involved, I might not get my money. And I don't know about them being my rock, because that rock is too slippery. But when your rock is Jesus Christ, that's the only rock that has enough support and weight behind it to cover up all of my sin. Do I have a witness in this place today? Is Jesus the rock of your salvation? Oh, come on, somebody. Stand up on your feet and give God a great big hand of praise. Jesus, the Lord, the Savior, the I am that I am, the rock of your salvation. Bless you. Hallelujah. It's prayer time, Morningstar. Time to have a little talk with the rock. For he knows every one of your needs before you even need them. He knows every one of your thoughts before you think them. Psalms 139 tells us that God is so intimate with us that he knew your form, yet being unformed. That he knew the number of hairs that was on your head. He said he knows you're lying down and you're rising up. He knows you're going in and you're going out. He knows your thoughts before you think it and your motivation. I don't know about you, but somebody that know me that deeply before I even can think it, I need to lean and trust in that person. And his name is I Am. Let us pray. Father God in heaven, Lord, we don't have enough time to exalt your name. I don't have enough mental faculties to think of all of your names. But as we are today, not out of any form, not out of any fashion, we just come humbly before the throne of grace this morning, seeking thy face. Thy face will I seek, your word says, because you are the I Am. You are the Almighty. You are the everything. You are the creator and the sustainer. You're the author and finisher of our faith. You're the lover and keeper of our soul. You're our yesterday. You are our right now. And you are our tomorrow, God. So, Father God, before we ask of anything, we first come to praise you and worship you. We come to magnify you. We come to lift up holy hands. We come to do a holy dance because you're great and greatly to be praised. And we realize, oh God, that you told us to get on that street called straight. Jesus sanctified us with holiness, but in our life, each and every day, we fall and we falter. We don't keep up with all of the commandments. We don't even study your word. But, oh God, pity us. Let your grace and let your mercy abound within us, that we might recover through the blood of the Lamb on Calvary Cross, that we would get back in line with you, that we, oh God, would seek you in everything that we say, in everything that we do, because you are the beginning and the end. Forgive us, oh Master, of our trespasses, those things that we've done that we know we've done and should not have done, but we did it anyway. Forgive us, oh God, of those sins that we did not realize that we committed, but we committed. But all the blood that washes us white as snow. Jesus died to set the captives free so that our sins would be blotted out. Not just sins of yesterday, but all of our sins when we come confessing that you are the Lord, you are the Savior, you are the Redeemer, you are the Propitiator, you are the Messiah, you are our Master and our friend. David says, oh God, in Psalm 40, that you pulled us out of the pit. Some of us, oh God, you pulled out of the pit of homosexuality. Thank you, Father God, that you didn't leave us in the pit. Some of us dealt with drugs of every kind. We battled, we stole, but you did not leave us in the pit. We worship our money. We worship hair. We worship our facial beings and our bodies and the things of this world. But you did not leave us in the pit. For you reached down from your glory seat. And you grabbed us by name, by name, by name. And you pulled us up out of the murk and out of the mire. And you set us on a solid rock. Jesus Christ, the living rock and our salvation. Oh God, you would go to the depths of hell to save your people. Thank you right now that you reached down and saved us. Thank you, Father God, that each and every day you're saving us and renewing us and making us over and over again in the image and likeness of your Son, Christ Jesus. For that, Lord, we shout hallelujah. For all of our needs, oh God. You know them. We pray, oh God, that you would meet us according to thine divine will. Open up the windows of heaven. Pour out blessings that we did not earn, but because of your love, because your barns are so full of goodness and mercy that you bless your children. Murder is everywhere. Gun violence is everywhere. Sins of every kind and every debauchery is everywhere. I know, Father God, because it's in all of our homes. It's on the streets of Cleveland. It's in war-torn countries where we spend more money killing than building up. We feed more people away from this country than we think about the poor and the homeless in our own home. Let the church be the church. Let the church be loving and kind. Let the church look past transgressions and sins and let love cover a multitude of sin like you covered us. Thank you for goodness. Thank you for a way out. Thank you that we can call upon your name every day. We don't need a mediator, for you are our mediator. Thank you for the throne of grace that we can boldly come and ask that thing that we will in confidence because of the blood of the Lamb on Calvary cross. Bless this house. Bless the house of prayer. Bless our pastor. Meet every need, Lord, within this house, in your house. Save the lost today. Let them know that in this dying world that is full of pain and suffering, that Jesus suffered, bled and died. He went to a borrowed tomb. He didn't intend on staying. He folded up his napkins, and in culture that meant he's coming back. He went to hell, defeated death, hell, and the grave. And early one Sunday morning, about the break of day, he got up. I said, he got up. He got up with all power in his hand. And because he lived, those who confess Jesus Christ will live victoriously with him by and by when that great getting up morning comes. And so for that, Lord, we just thank you. We honor you and glorify you because there's no name sweeter than the name of Jesus. Do a work in this place today, oh God. Let your spirit fall fresh among your people. Bless pastor as he preach and teach your word. Fill our cups until they are overflowing, oh God, that a change, oh, a change may take place in this place today according to thine divine will. And we'll be careful, oh God, to give your name all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. And for that we say amen. 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 And come on, this Shabbat, our God. He's worthy to be praised.
Just for a moment, because the Bible says this is the new day, a new week. We getting ready to start. Just put your hands together for a minute. Those of you that had a great week last week, you really should be putting your hands together. And think about the fact that God is great. Now, what I tell the choir when we work on this song is there's a commercial about Frosted Flakes. And some of you have heard of Tony the Tiger. And they tell you about these Frosted Flakes that what? They are what? Great, right? So now when we sing this song, I don't think we should talk more about some Frosted Flakes than we do about our God. Anybody agree with me? So when we sing it this time, I want you to think just a little bit about that tiger. And when we say great, I want you to put your hands and I want you to wave them around because God truly is great. Come on, choir.
We serve a great God, don't we? Who continually does great things in the lives of his people. Why don't you put your hands together one more time as we praise him, as we magnify him, as we lift up the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Isn't he a good God? Isn't he a wonderful God? I know he blessed somebody this past week. I know he opened up some doors for somebody that was going through. I know he made a way for somebody who couldn't find a way, because we serve a great God and he is greatly to be praised. Come on, put your hands together one more time at the music. Come on. He's great. I know he's great.
Right.
within my heart. Amen. God bless your mass choir for reminding us of that today, that the God we serve can do anything but fail. Are there any witnesses in the house here today? He can do the miraculous in our lives. He can do the impossible. We've seen it happen over and over and over again. His wonders to perform. Just a few pastoral observations, and then we're going to get right back into our worship and get ready for the spoken word of today. We certainly are lifting in prayer our own Reverend Dr. Nicole Calhoun, whose father was funeralized on yesterday. And certainly I didn't get a chance to mention some of the other families, the Martin and the Jones family and the passing of Kevin Jones, Kay Murphy and the passing of her brother, the Simmons family in the passing of several family members, amen, and of a niece who was a former member here at Morningstar Baptist Church. Anybody remember Valerie Prince from the old church? Well, she went home to be with the Lord, and so we certainly are lifting, again, that family up in prayer, and then our own Al Willis had death in his family. And then I received a call on yesterday that our own Lou McDaniels was in the hospital, but she's coming home today. Jackie Prather had a surgery, and she's recuperating and coming along well. Alan Range also had, this is the brother and one of our members, the brother of Will Range. He had surgery. Lauren Patterson Reed, we want to lift her in prayer. Reverend Eubanks, who should be coming back here real soon. Amen. God's done some great things in his life. For the husband of our own Diane Dozier, who also has been going through, but God has showed himself real in their life. And then for First Lady Tanya Hall, she's a trooper, y'all. She just keeps on fighting, and God keeps on showing up real in her life. And we just thank him for all that he has done with them. So why don't you put your hands together and just thank our God for all of the prayers that have been answered and for all of the wonderful miracles that he has performed. Just a couple of other quick notes. Our Silver Stars is going to be kicking off again on this coming Saturday from 12 to 2 p.m. Here in the Fellowship Hall. This is the first time that we have gathered together since before COVID. And we believe with the Lord's guidance that it's safe to be able to come out. And so we wanted to get our seniors back out and back engaged and to be able to fellowship one with the other. So we're going to have a meet and greet. You'll probably hear it in the announcements for the Silver Stars. Those who are 60 and up, and that probably is almost everybody in here, ain't it? 60 and up. But you know, if you're 60, that's a blessing. And so we want to celebrate God's goodness that he allowed you to see 60 and above. And so we just, 60 and up, there you go. And so we certainly are going to get together and start beginning to plan some of the activities that we're going to be doing throughout the rest of the course of this year. Perhaps trips, perhaps speakers coming in to speak to some of the needs that seniors need to hear about. Because there are folks that try to prey on seniors, not prey for them, but prey on them. And so we want to make sure that they're alert and that they're wise to some of these things that are going on. So if you're 60 and above and you want to come out and have some good fun, join our Silver Stars and be a part of us starting again this Saturday. And I believe it's the second Saturday of every month. Okay, but come out this Saturday and they'll give you all of the further instructions. Also, I just want to pass on that our phone system is down. We had some technical difficulties. We took a power hit and several of our systems went down, but praise God, we were able to get those back up. So if you want to call the church, you can't call the church on the phone, send us an email or send either Sister Powell or myself a text. And we'll be able to get that message. We don't want you to not be able to connect with us, especially in your times of need. And so until further notice, do that. We're going to try to get somebody in here this week to see what they can do to get our phone system back up and running again and back in service. And then the last thing I have is that you see all these beautiful lilies that are adorning our altar. Our Flower and Altar Guild did a great job, didn't they? They picked them out and they put them in place. Well, we want to be able to distribute those today and be able to give them a nice home that they can go and be watered and cared for and nurtured. And so how many do we have that are 80 and above here today? 80, not 8. I ain't top 80 and above. I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, I see about 6, 8, or 10, okay. All right, see Sister Edith after service today. Don't come and take them from the altar. She will assist you and get you a flower from the altar. We don't want no fights in here over some flowers. You know how folks do sometimes. I saw that one first. Amen. No. Christians don't fight, do we? Huh? Christians don't fight, do we? We learn how to be long-suffering, don't we? Endure patiently and to prefer others before ourselves. That's what the word says. Now, that ain't what Pastor Hall says, but that's what the word says. So, by all means, follow the directions and wait to be served by our own Sister Edith McGowan as she serves you these flowers immediately following the service. Amen. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store as God has prospered you. Giving, my brothers and sisters, in many ways is an ultimate way of being able to worship our God. Because you see, when we give God everything that we have, it says that he is large and in charge of our lives. And the way we sometimes hold on to our money, we hold on to it tight. And we don't let it go for too many folks and for too many things. And so maybe the sure test of whether or not you're trusting God is whether you trust him with your finances. Whether you're willing to do as he has commanded for us to do out of his word, to give a tenth off the top of what he has blessed us with. And watch him pour us out blessings from above that we don't have room enough to receive. Be mindful of the benevolence of our God. And we just sung that God is a great God and he's greatly to be praised. And that same great God is able to be able to do wonderful things for us in our lives if we learn how to be faithful and obedient unto him. Amen. Let's bow in prayer as we go to before the Lord. Father, we thank you again for this opportunity to give. We thank you for all those things that you've done in our lives that have made us realize and have given us the confidence and the boldness of knowing that you're a great God, that you continually do great things. And so, God, we come back today to give a portion of that which you have blessed us with for the upbuilding of your kingdom, for the furthering of the gospel being spread, to go forth to help those who are less fortunate than us, who are standing in need today. And so, Father, we come and we give cheerfully and we give out of obedience today. And we pray that you would bless not only the gift, but bless the giver. And that, oh God, you would press down that which remains and that you'll let it run over full of your grace and full of your mercy. We love you, we praise you, and we thank you today. And we ask all these things right now in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen, amen. Come on, put your hands together and bless the name of our Lord. I forgot to mention real quick, and then we'll be ready to go right into as you're taking up the offering and just before the video announcements. We did have a number of thank you cards from Renee Smith. We certainly want to thank, she thanks the church for praying for her and being there in a time of need, for the Earl Morrison family, for the Rosalind Cole family. This is from Denise Young and that family. And this is also from William and Mary Simmons and family. And then certainly from Suzette Travis and Deacon Johnny Martin. We certainly want to remember all of them and thank them for their cards and expressions of thanksgiving. Let us now prepare to give.
Good morning and welcome to Morningstar Baptist Church. I want you to prepare for a worship experience where we celebrate, worship, and connect. I'm so excited and I hope that you are also. I'm Chandra Johnson here with your MSBC News. Tithing, it's more than giving. It's investing in something greater. So let's sow generously and reap abundantly together, knowing that every contribution makes a difference in building the kingdom of God. There are a few ways for you to invest. If you feel comfortable investing electronically, you can choose from PayPal, Givelify, or Cash App. But if we're together in worship, just raise your hand and an usher will bring you an envelope. Or stop by the post office and drop your investment in the mail. Prayer is our direct line to solace, guidance, and growth. It offers strength and adversity, clarity and confusion, and abundant gratitude. Let's make sure that we extend these characteristics outside of our church and to those on our prayer list. Listen up. The following two announcements are just for you. The Men of Valor are inviting you to attend their conference on April 19th and April 20th. You know that iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. You can register for this free event at movemanupnation.org. After you've taken care of your spiritual man, you must also check in on your physical man. So I'm inviting you to sign up for the Metro Health Men's Health Fair on Saturday, April 27th, 2024. There's going to be various health screenings and community and career resources. You also have the option of two locations to choose from. So head on over to metrohealth.org/MMF to register today. Attention all Silver Stars. They want you to join them for a meet and greet on Saturday, April 13th from noon to 2. They've missed you and they can't wait to see you. There is nothing that beats the feeling of worshiping in person, to experience God in His house with other like-minded worshipers. That's why I'm inviting you to join us at Morning Star Baptist Church at 10 a.m. Your presence will be a valuable addition to our journey together. You are welcome to come as you are and share in the warmth of our fellowship and faith. We'll see you next Sunday. Connection is vital, and that's why we want to stay connected. So follow us on social media or visit our website for more information about this fantastic church. Now the time has come to put everything aside so that we can receive a word from the Lord. I'm Chandra Johnson, and this has been your MSBC News. Thank you.
Thank you.
shall. He'll be my strength. Yes, he will. Come on, put your hands together, Morning Star, and just thank a God who loves us so much, who's always there for us in our time of need. God bless your choir for reminding us of that today. And I just want you to know that you'll never really experience anything like that until you really had a personal relationship with God for yourself. Until you've experienced a relationship with God for yourself. Is that better? It's better to have him and not need him than to need him and not have him. And it's only in those times when we find ourselves down in the valley or in the pits or up against the giants or up against the wall that we really, really, our faith is really put to the test. And we really, really find out for ourselves that God will be our shelter in a time of storm, in the times of trouble. That God will give you strength even when you don't feel that you can take another step or you can go another inch. Anybody know that God will give you your second wind and God will help you through your crisis and God will be there for you in your time of need? He'll be your shelter and he will be your strength. Praise God for that. This morning, for a few moments, I just want to draw your attention to the book of Romans, the 8th chapter. And we're going to be settling in around verses 28 through 34. Romans chapter 8, verses 28 through 34. And when you found it, I ask that you would joyfully stand to your feet for the reading of his word. You may have a multitude of translations out in the audience and over the airway today, but I'm going to be again sharing this passage and reading it from the Message translation. Because again, once I believe that it shares and says what I believe God would have us to hear today. From Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 28, we find these words. That's why we can be sure that every detail in our lives of love for God is worked into something good. I like that. King James says, all things work together for the good of those that love God, who are called according to his purpose. Verse 29, God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. He decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. The son stands first in the line of humanity he restored. We see the original and intended shape of our lives there in him. After God made that decision of what his children should be like, he followed it up by calling people by name. After he called them by name, he set them on a solid basis with himself. And then after getting them established, he stayed with them. Woo! Yeah, he stayed with them to the end. He stayed with them to the end. He shall be my shelter and he shall be my strength. Gloriously completing what he began in them. So what do you think? With God on our side, like this, how can we lose? If God didn't hesitate to put everything on the line for us, embracing our condition and exposing himself to the worst by sending his own son, is there anything else he wouldn't gladly and freely do for us? And who would dare tangle with God by messing with one of God's chosen? Yeah, who would dare even to point a finger? The one who died for us, who was raised to life for us, is in the presence of God at this very moment, sticking up for us. Sticking up for us. Sticking up for us. This is the word of the Lord. Father, once again, we entreat your presence here today, that you would kindly speak through the means and the method of your Holy Spirit into the hearts and the lives of all of us here today. All we get is just a glimpse. All we can see is what we can see either naturally or what your Holy Spirit has unveiled for us. Unveil for us a deeper meaning and a deeper relationship with you today, that we may know you today like we've never known you before. And may we commit our lives and ourselves to you, O God, in such a way that you can use us for your glory and for the upbuilding of your kingdom. And then may we fall in line with your Son, Jesus Christ, following in his steps, that just as he suffered, oh yes, sometimes we're going to suffer, but just as he rose, one day, Lord, we're going to rise again triumphantly. And so we can, again, thank you today for your blessings, for your grace, for this act of love that you've shown to us. And so speak to our hearts today. Speak to our minds. Speak to our troubles. Speak to our worry that we have in our hearts and as we face giants and situations in our lives. And help us to realize, oh God, that you are God Almighty and there's nothing that's too hard for you. We thank you, we praise you, we pray that I might decrease and that you might increase, and that now your Holy Spirit might have his way today. This is your servant's prayer that I ask in Jesus' name and for his sake. Let every heart say amen, amen. And thank God, amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. And from this setting, if you will, I just want to share with you from the thought, he's on my side. Yeah, yeah, yeah. A word of confidence, a word of assurance that he's on my side. Everything that the devil did to stop Jesus didn't work. Oh, he tried to have him killed at birth, if you remember the story. Amen. But it didn't work. He tried tempting Jesus when Jesus had been in the wilderness for 40 days and for 40 nights, and he was weak and he was weary and he was at a low point in his life, but it didn't work. He tried spreading lies about Jesus in an attempt to try to discredit him and to keep folks from following him and believing in him, but it didn't work. He even raised up religious leaders, church folks, if you will, to falsely accuse Jesus, had him condemned to death, and ultimately crucified Jesus on the cross. Perhaps the devil himself thought that if he could just kill Jesus, that he would get rid of him once and for all. But I submit to you today, my brothers and sisters, that apparently the devil didn't get the memo. Or at the very least, he failed to take the time to read his email message. For if he did, he would have clearly found out and it would have been revealed to him that no matter what happens to us and no matter what goes down in our life, that it ain't over till God says it's over. I don't care how dark it might be. I don't care how overwhelming it might seem. God always has the last word. Amen. Thus, the devil gave it his best shot. Oh, yes, he did. He gave it his best shot. But every time he gave it his shot, he always came up short. Nothing that he did was good enough to work to keep Jesus, the Son of God, down. And it didn't work because the devil is no match for our God. I said, the devil is no match for our God. Why do you say that, preacher? I say that because God is all powerful. I say that because God is the ruler of all things. I say that because God is above everything and everyone and every power and every situation and every organization. God is above everything. He is the King of Kings and He is the Lord of Lords, and the devil is no match for our God. But you need to know today that he does not give up that easy. The devil didn't tuck his tail and run and hide when Jesus got up out of the grave. That's what I'm trying to say. He doesn't give up when he loses a situation or he loses an encounter or he loses a battle. The devil does not give up that easy. And today I submit to you that he still tries with all of his might to attack the kingdom of God. If he can't get the head, he'll get the body. If he can't get the leader to fall, he'll scatter the followers. If he can't stop you from believing, he'll try to stop you from coming to church. The devil will try to do all that he can. And though he couldn't stop Jesus from getting up, bless God, that doesn't stop him from trying to keep you and I down. Every day he knocks on our door. Every day he pushes our buttons. Every day he sits at our table. Every day he sleeps in our bed and sometimes follows us around everywhere we go. I'm saying he doesn't give up because he doesn't want you to believe that God is a God who can do it all. He doesn't want you to believe that God is the God of all. He doesn't want you to follow where God is ultimately trying to take you, for he doesn't want you to succeed and to be the benefactor, if you will, of all of the blessings that God already has with your name on it. Don't you know that the devil already knows that God is a good God and he's greatly to be praised? He already knows that. He already knows what God is able to do to those who put their faith and their hope and trust in. He already knows that. And he already knows that when we call upon the Lord, that the Lord will come and he'll hear and answer our prayer. He already knows that. So what does he do? He tries to shut our mouths. He tries to keep us from worshiping. He tries to keep us from praying. He tries to get us to keep our focus off of the Lord and ultimately diminish our faith. He don't want you to be blessed. No, he doesn't. He doesn't want you to trust in God with all thine heart and to lean not into your own understanding. Instead, he wants you to bow and to follow him. Amen. So what does he do? He turns around and he throws his punches, if you will. And he finds a weak spot in your life or in your situation. He finds a place where he goes after you with everything that he's got. Anybody felt the blows of Satan before? I said, has anybody in here ever felt the blow of Satan before? Amen. Before you knew it, you ended up doing something that you knew you shouldn't have done, but somehow or another, he caught you off guard and he hit you with that right hook and down you went for the count. Somehow or another, you knew that you should not have fallen to the prey of the temptations of the things of this world, but yet he made it so tempting. He made it look so good. Sometimes he made it look so easy. He made it look as though that nobody was looking. And so if nobody's looking, I can do it and I can get away with it. But that's the way the devil works. Because even though nobody else saw what you did, God still saw what you did. God knows every moment, every second, and even know the thoughts that are in our head. God saw it all. And he will do everything, Satan will do everything in order to get us to shatter our faith and to destroy our dreams and even make you give up and to lose all hope. And that's why the resurrection is so important. Oh, yes, it is. You see, just because he lands a punch or two and even wins a few rounds, because he won some few rounds on me. I want y'all to know that. And I'm not the only one that the devil has won a few rounds on in here today, truth be told. If you were honest with yourself and honest with God today, you have fallen a many a time. You have been sucker punched a number of times. You have caught the bait and you bit on whatever it was that he threw your way a number of times. And so he may win a few rounds and he may even get a few punches in. But rest assured, my brothers and sisters, the devil never, ever wins the fight. Oh, that somebody ought to rejoice about that today. Yeah, I may be down, but I'm not out. I may have fallen, but guess what? With God's grace, I can get back up again. As Christians, we already know the end of the story. We know that, yes, in this world, we're going to have some trials and tribulations. Yes, we're going to go through some temptation, moments of temptation. Yes, we're going to have some ups and downs. But in the end, I know that God's loved me and God will care for me and God's blood will cover me from all of my sins. And in the end, we're going to win. In the end, we're on the winning side. We're on the winning team because one day we decided to make Jesus our choice. Amen. He may get a few blows in. He may get a couple of rounds that he might win, but the devil never ultimately wins the fight because really and truthfully, the fight isn't against you and your neighbor. The fight really isn't against you and your husband or your wife. No, no, no. Or your friend or significant other. Nothing. That's not who the real fight is against, is with. The real fight is between God and Satan. Between good and evil. Between right and wrong. That's where the real fight is. And yet we get duped in every time. And we find ourselves fighting against one another. You know, I asked y'all, I was a little trick question earlier. Christians don't fight. Hey, man, that was a little trick question. That was a trick question. Amen. Amen. And we end up fighting one another over stuff and over issues and over things that sometimes we don't have any control over. And we fail to realize that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof and everything that dwells therein. Everything. And so God has all power. Yes, sir. He has demonstrated once and for all on the day that Jesus got up from the grave. Amen. And he declared that all power had been given unto him in heaven and in earth. And so when it comes to you and I, my brothers and sisters, the reason he can't win, the reason why he's not going to win, amen, is because every time he comes after you, every time he chases you, every time he thinks that he has you cornered, that's when Jesus steps in. Anybody got a witness in here today? That's when Jesus steps in. And when Jesus steps in, Jesus takes up for you. Much like a big sister or a big brother on the playground of life, if you will. And Jesus comes around and he becomes that big brother or that big sister to us who looks out for us and even goes before us and is always there to help us. Anybody glad about that today? I got a big brother who's looking out for me. In fact, if you really had a big brother in real life, I mean, you didn't worry about anything because all you do is just call your brother. Hey, amen. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. You call your sister because they were bigger and bad and they had a reputation. And nobody messed with my brother. Nobody messed with my sister. And so sometimes we would even start stuff. And then call our big brother and big sister to come in and finish it for us. Oh, y'all know I'm right. And so Jesus becomes our big brother who every time we find ourselves in a battle and in a confrontation with the devil himself, Jesus steps in and prevents the bully, the devil himself, from beating you down. Somebody say amen to that today. Because that's all the devil is a big bully. He's got a bark, but he really ain't got no bite.
He can shout loud and try to get your attention, but he can never destroy your faith. Because the faith that I have is in a God who is all eternal and a God who can do all things exceedingly well. And so he tries to get his bluff in. He tries to get us to buckle. He tries to get us to bite. But the devil never wins. In the end, he will never win. When you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you became a part of his forever family. That makes us all brothers and sisters in Christ. You know that, don't you? Amen. And we became a part of his forever family. And he became your big brother, if you will, who looks out for you, who goes before you, and who's always there for you in your time of need. Hebrews 7 and 25 says, "Wherefore he's able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to maketh intercessions for them." Amen. Somebody say, he's on my side. The scriptures tells me that the Lord Jesus Christ is on my side, that he goes before me, he holds my hand, he carries me through some of the crises that I find myself in. And that's very important for you to remember today, to know that even at this very moment, if you will, that the Jesus of the empty tomb is right now sitting on the right hand of God our Father in heaven, pleading your case and making intercessions on you and on your behalf. Why? Why is he doing it? He's doing it because he's on your side. He's on your side. And he wants to help you through. He wants you to succeed. He wants you to be able to rise above all these frivolous things, if you will, that have a tendency to weigh us down. Listen, evil must pass through Jesus before it can touch you. Think about that. Yeah. It has to ask permission even before it can lay a hand on you. You don't believe me? Go back and read the story of Job. It's got to get God's permission before it can touch you or tempt you or test you. And the question perhaps really should be, can God count on us like he could count on Job? Have you considered my servant? And then put your name in there. Can God count on you to walk upright? Can God count on you to follow his voice and his leading? Can God count on you to do what needs to be done and to hear his voice and to follow him by faith? Amen. Amen. God will never let us be pushed past our limits. He knows what you and I can handle. And he knows what your limitations are. In fact, the songwriter says he knows just how much we can bear. And because of that, he's always there. Amen. To rescue you and even to see you through. No wonder the psalm writer wrote in Psalm 118 and 6, it says, "The Lord is on my side. I will not fear what man can do unto me." And that's why right here in our text, the Apostle Paul writes to us to encourage us when we find ourselves struggling and facing trials of every kind, battles and storms that will certainly rage in all of our lives. He reminds us that any time we find ourselves going through those perilous times, that we are never, 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 ever alone. In fact, he tells us that we're not in this struggle all by ourselves, and that when we do face opposition and when we do go through what we're going through, that whatever it looks like and whatever it feels like, God has a way of taking that which looks bad and he can turn it around and make something good out of it. Anybody know what I'm talking about in here? All things work together for the good of those who love God and who are called, or are the called according to his purpose. That means even setbacks, they're no match for our God. Disappointments, they're no match for our God. In fact, Sometimes we have setbacks in order that he might set us up for something greater and grander that he has in store for us. Amen. Amen. When the Lord is on your side, he's more than the world against you. And so Paul reminds us that the reason that the tomb is empty today is because Jesus is sitting on the right hand of God. Amen. Making intercessions. Amen. For you and for me, pleading your case. I need somebody to plead my case. Amen. I mess up so many times, you wouldn't believe it. And I need somebody to plead my case. In fact, if I had your number, I might call your number and ask you to help me to get back in the house sometimes. Hello. Y'all laugh, but I'm serious. And at the same time, I know I'm not alone. Ain't that right, Brother Craig? Amen. We all go through things and we all find ourselves tempted and we all find ourselves in struggles and we all find ourselves in confrontations and we all find ourselves in disagreements. And it's not easy sometimes for the two to become one. Oh, no, it's not. Because, you know, I got my way and she's got her way and you've got your way and they've got their way. And, you know, and we determine we're hell-bent that it's going to go my way. And, you know, they're hell-bent that it's going to go their way. And so what we end up doing is the devil has now pushed each one of our buttons. Amen. And made each one of us go after one another. When in reality, here we are fighting one another when my spouse is not really the enemy. The devil is really the one. He loves to stir up confusion. He loves for you to sleep on the couch. He loves for you to be able to be in the doghouse. Yeah, yeah. He loves for you to walk around and to pout and to say nothing all day to one another. He loves that. That's his way of driving that wedge sometimes in between us and keeping us from having that unity that can only be found in Christ Jesus. Somebody say amen to that today. Amen. And so if God is for us, who can be against us? When the Lord himself is on our side, then he's more than the world against us. In other words, God is looking out for you. He's defending you. He's protecting you. He steps in. I've seen that happen a number of times. He steps in when it's too much for you to bear. And if you really don't want God to do something, don't pray and ask God to do it. Hello. And if you do pray, you better make sure you're sincere about what you're praying for. Because God already knows what you need. In fact, God probably put the words in your mouth and in your mind in the first place for you to pray that prayer in the first place because you thought you didn't know what you needed, but God knew exactly what you needed to get you out of that jam and to get you out of that situation. Amen. When it's too much for us to bear, God always finds a way out for us. In the world of professional wrestling, they have all kinds of crazy matches. Any wrestling fans in the house today? Nobody, huh? Two, three, four. Okay, I fake stuff. But it's entertaining. And there are those that get something out of the wrestling matches. But in the world of professional wrestling, they have what's called steel cage matches. These are matches that took place in a ring that was surrounded by chicken wire, if you will, to keep the athletes on the inside so that you can't get out of the ring until you get knocked out or until the fight is over with. Or perhaps even better yet, to prevent any potential interference from somebody on the outside coming in to rescue you from what you're going through. They also have what's called grudge matches. A grudge match is a contest or a fight between players or teams who don't like nobody. They don't like one another. And so because they don't like one another, it's a fight to the finish. It's a grudge match. and let the best man win. Amen. Then there are matches when the last one standing wins the match. The last man standing matches is where a wrestler has to hurt their opponent enough so that he cannot make it to his feet before the count of 10. Amen. There are no pinfalls, meaning you can't pin them down on the mat. There are no submission, he can't cry uncle. Amen. No. There are no disqualifications whatsoever, almost as though the referee just holds a blind eye. He lets anything go. Amen. There is no count out. You know how they do. There's no count out even in that kind of match. But the only way in that particular match for someone to win is that you have to be down and you can't get back up on your feet again. Amen. Down and you can't get back up. Amen. But one or of the more traditional kinds of matches, if you will, besides the one-on-one match, is what's called a tag team wrestling match. Anybody know about a tag team match? Amen. This is a match where you and a partner are teamed up against two other wrestlers, but only one wrestler from each team can be in the ring fighting at any given time. The way that the other wrestler is able to get into the ring legally, and I underscore the word legally, the only way they can get in legally is for the one who is in the ring to tag his partner. Are you following me? And when your partner is tagged, then your partner can jump in the ring and he can go to your rescue and he can go and fight the opponent and he can take over where you left off and he can fight against the other enemy that's in the ring. Well, I submit to you today, my brothers and sisters, that today you and the Lord are in a tag team match against the devil himself. And anytime you're in the ring of life and you're in the ring where things are going all haywire and chaotic and confusion, amen, anytime it gets too hard and the enemy looks like it's getting the best of you, all you have to do is to remember that you got a partner. Yeah, I got a partner. I don't have to fight this fight all by myself. I don't have to go all the way to the end all by myself. I don't have to knock my opponent out all by myself. I don't have to wear them out and make them weary all by myself because I've got a partner. Amen. I got a partner, and my partner is there to help me to win the battle that I'm in. And all I have to do is remember not only that I have a partner, but all I have to do is when I find myself in a tough situation is to somehow or another find a way to get over and to tag my partner. I may not always be on my feet in order to get to the ropes to be able to tag my partner, but that don't matter because even I have to crawl over to the ropes to tag my partner. That's still okay. All that really matters is that I can reach over and I can tag my partner. And when I tag my partner then jumps in the ring and he jumps to my rescue and he comes to my aid and he takes over where I left off. And I submit to you today, my brothers and sisters, that Jesus is your partner. He's on your side. He's there to help you win the grudge matches of life. He's there to help you to win all of the battles that we find ourselves up against. He's there to help you to win and not to lose. And when Jesus gets into the ring, when you tag him when you've had enough and you tag him when you've reached your extremities and you tag him when all of your energy is gone, when you tag Jesus, amen. Jesus jumps into the ring. Anybody seen Jesus jump into your situation and jump into your problem and jump into your storm and cause the storms to cease and to have peace? Anybody saw Jesus jump into your situation when you were in the hospital room and your body was racked with pain and the doctors did not know if you were going to make it or not? All you did was through your prayer, tag Jesus. Woo! And I know that when I tag Jesus, that Jesus is not going to sit on the sidelines and say, does he want me to come in or not? No. Jesus knows what a tag means. I said, Jesus knows what a tag means. J- Jesus knows what a tag means when it comes to his sons and his daughters, and he knows that when they tag me, they need me. When they tag me, they reach their extremities. When they tag me, they can't go no further on their own. And so all we have to do is reach out and tag Jesus. Through prayer, tag Jesus. Through our heart and through our spirit that was within us, tag Jesus and let him step into the ring of your life. And when Jesus gets into the ring, the devil has to back up. Oh, yes, he does. When Jesus steps into the ring, the devil has to back away from the situation. When Jesus steps into the ring, the devil doesn't stand a chance at all. When Jesus steps into the ring, I don't know how he does it, but I know that he does it, but that he makes the devil somehow behave. He takes the sting, if you will, out of the punch that the devil is trying to land on us. And he loosens the hold, if you will, that the devil has on us. In other words, he breaks the chains and he breaks the yokes and he breaks the habits and he breaks the desires and he gets us to change from what we used to be into where we need to be in him today. Why? Because we tag Jesus. And Jesus came into our life. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying when you have the Lord on your side, you're on the winning side. That if God is for you, he's more than the world against you. That if God is for you, what can man do unto you? And that's why today I'm so glad that he's on my side. I'm so glad that I'm on the winning side. I'm so glad that I'm on the winning team. And as long as I've got King Jesus, I don't need nobody else. I don't need nothing else because I know that the Lord will supply all of my needs. It doesn't matter what the odds are against you. If he's on your side, he'll see you through it. It doesn't matter if the circumstances that you're facing even seem insurmountable. Is there anything that's too hard for our God? It doesn't matter even if it looks hopeless. Because we saw that the empty tomb looked hopeless to the disciples. Everything that they trusted in was had in their eyes gone down the drain. But that was only Friday. But oh, when Sunday came and the stone was rolled away and the angels came and they said, why are you seeking the living among the dead? He is not here because Jesus has risen just like he said. Didn't he say he would heal you? Didn't he say that he would open up doors for you? Didn't he say that he would be there for you in your time of need? All you have to do is remember is that you're not in this thing all by yourself. I'm not alone. For yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death even, I will fear no evil. Why? Because thou art with me. And that the Lord is truly on your side. Listen, you're not fighting those battles all by yourself. No. You're not in the ring all by yourself. I know sometimes it feels that way. It feels as though nobody understands you, nobody can relate to you, that you're going through these struggles all by yourself. In fact, nobody even cares. Huh? Have you ever felt that way sometimes? Nobody cares, nobody cares, nobody cares, nobody cares. Y'all ain't being truthful, nobody cares. My children don't care, husband don't care, wife don't care, boss don't care, saints don't care. Amen. And if you did not say it, you at least felt it. Amen. And so when we find ourselves in those situations, we have to allow our faith within us to rise to the occasion and to remember that no matter what it looks like, things aren't always what they appear to be. That I am not a loser when the Lord is on my side. For this trial that I'm facing, I'm not facing it alone. The battle that I'm fighting, I'm not fighting it all alone. And that means that as long as the Lord is on my side, I am a conqueror through him that loves me. Amen. That as long as the Lord is on my side, I am a survivor and I will not be defeated. Amen. As long as the Lord is on my side, I am a winner. Amen. And not a loser. Yes, and because he's on my side, he's more than the world against me. Therefore, I will not quit. I will not give up. I will not throw in the towel. I will not be defeated. I will not bite when the devil comes to knocking on my door. I will not give in to the temptation when it comes my way. I will not surrender. Why? Because greater is he that is within me than he that is in the world. And as long as Jesus is in me, I've got everything that I need. Anybody glad that he's on your side today? Anybody glad that he is the one who's fighting your battles today? Anybody glad that he's defending your case today? Listen, he can only be on your side, though, if you choose him as your partner. Huh? He can only be on your side if you choose him. If you don't choose him and you ignore him and you reject him, then you fight that battle all by yourself. Heaven help you, and I'll pray for you. But you're going to need Jesus. You're going to need somebody through some phase of your life that you're going through. Through some storm, through some death, through some sickness, through some poverty. You're going to need the Lord in your life. And if you pick him, he'll fight those battles for you. If you pick him, he'll take care of you every time. If you pick him, that makes him your partner. And I submit to you today that if the Lord truly is your partner, that means he's on your side. Are you glad about that today? Are you glad that he's on your side? What can man do unto me? For as long as the Lord is on my side, he's more than the world against me. And so I just need to continue to lift up my faith unto him, to look to the hills from which cometh all my help, because all my help cometh from the Lord. And so when I look to the hills, in essence, he already knows my heart, and he knows I'm reaching out for that tag. They say, Lord, I've done all I can do. Lord, I've gone as far as I can go. Lord, I've come up empty here now. I'm tired. I'm weary. I'm worn. I'm struggling, Lord, and I need you. I need you to come into the ring of my life, and I need you to straighten out those things that need to be fixed. Amen. And don't you know that he can do it? Yes, I said, don't you know that he can do it? In fact, that was last Sunday's sermon. He can do it. He can do it. He can do it because he's on my side. And if you're really happy about that today, why don't you put your hands together and just bless our God and thank him for being your God, your Lord, your Savior, your keeper, your deliverer, your helper, your provider, your comforter in your times of need. Father, we thank you today for how you reveal yourself to us in many affectionate ways. For you know the hearts of your children, and you know all that we go through each and every day. You know our road and you know our path even before we get there. And we're just grateful that you prepare the way before us. You order our steps in many cases in order that we might follow your will and follow your way. We can't see straight half the time, oh God, and that's why we even have to have corrective lenses in the natural to help us to see far away or even help to see what's right beneath our nose. And so spiritually speaking, oh God, correct our lenses, our vision, and help us to see what we in the flesh could not see. But by faith in you, we know that all things are possible. We thank you for this message today, Lord, that reminds us and encourages us that we don't have to go through the struggles and the ups and downs of life all alone. But we serve a God who's promised that he would be there with us. He would walk with us and talk with us and strengthen us and help us and lead us and guide us and hold us even in our times of need. Lord, thank you for holding us when we felt as though we were all alone. Thank you for holding us and keeping us even when we could not keep ourselves. Thank you for stepping in and making a way out of no way. Taking our crazy mind and bringing some order and some semblance to it. Helping us to think straight, to walk straight, to live straight according to your word. And so, God, right now, we believe that there's somebody here today who may not know you as Lord and Savior, who yeah, they've been in the boxing ring or the wrestling ring all through life, and they've been fighting this and fighting that and fighting the other and wrestling with this thing and wrestling with that thing, and they're wondering why it is that they wrestle so hard and so long that they just can't make it another round. But help them to realize that if they would only open up the door and allow you to come into their life, all they have to do is choose you today. And when they choose you, oh God, you team up with them and help them through every situation that they're facing. Give them a desire today to choose you, Lord, to make you their choice, to make you their Lord and their Savior, to not want to live another day without having you on their side, that you might walk with them and talk with them and help them through everything that they're going through. We've seen you do it before, Lord, and we know that you could do it again. We've seen how you've healed some, and we know how that you have enough healing in your garment to heal us, heal others. And so, God, we just pray right now that you'll provide even that spiritual healing that's needed today to some man, some woman, some boy, or some girl who may be struggling and looking for the course that they must take. Help them to choose you while they yet have a chance. And we ask this prayer right now in Jesus' name and for his sake. Let every heart say amen and thank God. The doors of the church are open. I'm going to ask that you would stand all over the sanctuary as we extend this invitation to someone who may be here, who's been struggling, and they've been looking for an answer. They've been looking for a way out. They've been looking for some deliverance to take place in their life. And they found it in God's word today. For his word says, seek me and shall find me if you search for me with all of your heart. If that's your desire today, then won't you come? Is there another? Won't you come today? He's able. Won't you come? Don't wait for tomorrow. But come right now.